Well, shalom, everybody. It is such a great honor and privilege to be here with you all tonight. And I just want to say a real big thank you to my brother, my friend, Mr. Tom Cantor. he doesn't like it when we clap for him, but we really do need to because he is such an inspiration. He is such a great minister of the gospel. And as somebody who is a little bit younger than Mr. Cantor, I just want to say thank you so much for being such a blessing and for being an inspiration. And it is a great privilege for me to be here with you all tonight and share with you. For everything that was written in the past was written to teach us, so that through endurance and the encouragement of the scriptures, we might have hope. Everything that was written in the past, in the Old Testament, God deliberately chose certain historical events from the lives of the Old Testament saints and recorded them in the Bible because these events contain spiritual lessons for us followers of Jesus Christ today. Now, the book of Genesis is full of these saints. If you got your Bibles with you, open with me to Genesis chapter 12, and we will read from verses 1 to 9. If you didn't bring your Bible, your book of the Bible, maybe you can just turn on your Bible in one of your devices. If you don't have that, don't worry. I'll also have all the scriptures on the screen. Now, while you open in your Bible, let me say today that today what I want us to do is I want to answer three questions for us, okay? First, I want us to answer this question of how did the Jewish people came into being? Secondly, I want us to answer how did the promised land became the Jewish people's inheritance? And thirdly, I want to ask, okay, so who cares? What difference does that make for us, okay? So here we go, beginning with Genesis chapter 12. Verse 1. Now the Lord said to Abram, go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you, and I will make you a great nation, and I will bless you and make your name great so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you I will curse, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Verse 4, so Abram went as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he departed from Haran, and Abram took Sarai his wife, and Lot his brother's son, and all their possessions that they had gathered, and the people that they had acquired in Haran, and they set out to go to the land of Canaan. When they came to the land of Canaan, Abram passed through the land to the place at Shechem, to the oak of Moriah. At that time, the Canaanites were in the land. Verse 7. Then the Lord appeared to Abram and said, to your offsprings I will give this land. So he built there an altar to the Lord who had appeared to him. From there he moved to the hill country on the east of Bethel and pitched his tent with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. And there he built an altar to the Lord and called upon the name of the Lord. And Abram journeyed on, still going toward the Negev. Now, the origin of the Jewish people all started with a man named Abram. Around 2000 BC, God decided to prepare a special race of people to become a special nation in order to carry out a special purpose. And of course, that's the nation of Israel, right? Now, Israel's threefold special purpose was to give the world, number one, the knowledge of the one true God. Number two, Israel's second special purpose was to give the world the written word of God, the Bible. And number three, Israel's third special purpose was to give the world, the Messiah. Now the Lord said to Abram, leave your country and your relatives and your father's household and go to the land that I will show you. Verse 1. God has asked Abraham to step out by faith and walk into completely unknown territory with only the promises of God to sustain him. So, what did Abram do? So Abram went forth just as the Lord has spoken to him. Verse 4, Abram obeyed. Because he obeyed, the Abrahamic covenant came to be. Now, the Abrahamic covenant consists in it six promises that God makes to Abram, as we just read in Genesis 12. And as we look at these promises, I want us to ask ourselves, does God keep his promises? Is God a promise-keeping God? Well, let's see. The Abrahamic covenant has six provisions, like I mentioned. Number one, you can find it in verse 2, I will make you into a great nation. Another promise, promise number 2, I will bless you, Abram. Well, if you would skip to Genesis 13, verse 2, you would see now Abram was very rich in livestock, in silver, and in gold. He was indeed became a great nation. He was blessed. God blessed him. Provision number 3, and I will make your name great. Now, stop right here and let's think about this for a second. Is Abraham's name great? Well, if you think about it, really he is, and maybe the one common thing that we have with the other monotheistic religions, you know, Judaism and Islam. Right now, we as followers of Jesus, we don't agree with them on much, right? I mean, we don't agree much with the Muslims. We don't agree much with the rabbis, right? But hey, we all agree that Abraham is a hero, right? We all agree that Abraham was a great man. So was his name great? It is. I mean, Abraham's name is great today. Let's move on. Number 4, verse 3, all peoples on earth will be blessed through you, which relates to number 5 as well. Verse 7, to your offspring I will give this land. You see, through Abraham and his offsprings, we have the Bible, right? We have Messiah. Hey, I've been blessed through Abraham, have you? Amen? Right? And I got to tell you, I was born and raised in Israel, in a typical Israeli home, secular home. You know, my parents are atheists, so they would really, I wish I could bring them to this creation museum, you know? Growing up in an atheist home, I never really bought into my parents' atheism. You know, I always believed that God was real. And it was when our family moved to New York City, when I was attending Stony Brook University, and while I was tutoring students who needed extra help with math, is when I met a girl named Dina. And I helped her with her math homework, and she kind of recognized my accent in English, so she asked me if I was Russian. And I said to Dina, no, I'm not Russian, I'm Israeli. And she says, wow, great, we've got something in common. So we continued in the conversation. And at some point in the conversation, Dina tells me that she believes in Yeshua. Now, being fluent in Hebrew, I know what the word Yeshua means. It means salvation. But I've never heard of such a name because nobody in Israel today is named Yeshua. So I asked Dina, who is this Yeshua that she believes in? And she tells me that it's Jesus. Now, was I shocked? For two reasons. Number one, to find out that Jesus' real Hebrew name was salvation, was Yeshua. Second of all, I've never met before a Jewish person who believed in Jesus. So I was really curious, and I met with Dina for lunch a few days later, and it was during that lunch that Dina opened the Old Testament scriptures to me and shared with me prophecies about the Messiah. And then she showed me in the New Testament how Jesus, how Yeshua, fulfilled each and every one of those prophecies. And praise God, a few days later, I prayed with Dina to receive the Lord. Amen. Now, 2 years later, Dina and I got married, so praise God for that as well. You see, through Abraham, we have Jesus, the Messiah. I've been blessed through Abraham and all the people on the earth as well. Now, the number 5 provision here, to your offsprings I will give the land. Well, I'm a visible representation for that for you, coming all the way from Israel today. I'm a living testimony of the land promise, being born and raised in Israel. As Jewish people, we're back in the land that God promised Abraham's descendants. Now, you have to remember, we're back in the land, but in an unbelief. And we'll get to that in a second. But let's move on to number 6, verse 3. I will bless those who bless you and curse those who curse you. All through the ages, there have been people who cursed the Jews and tried to kill us. Pharaoh in Exodus, the Persians, the Philistines, Haman, the Spanish Inquisition, and Caesar's Russia, communist Russia, Hitler and Nazi Germany, and I can go on and on and on. And yet here we are, thousands of years after Abraham, and you know what? There are still Abraham's descendants. And you know, as we think about, wow, I will bless those who bless you. So how can we bless Israel? What should we do? Well, let me tell you that the best way to bless Israel is with Jesus. Amen. The best thing in my life, I hope the best thing in your life as well, is Jesus. Amen, amen to that. Amen. Amen. The best way to bless Israel, the best way to bless Abraham's descendants is with Jesus. Why do I say that? I say that because you need to support Israel Restoration's ministries. That's what they're all about. That's what they're doing. And it's my privilege, my honor to partner with them to bring the gospel to the people in Israel, to bring the gospel to the Jewish people all over the world. You need to stand and you need to support and you need to pray for Israel Restoration's ministry. Amen? Amen? And those who bless you, I will bless. You see, God asked Abraham to leave his homeland so he could start a new people, the Jewish people. God made Abraham 6 promises. All Abraham had to do was to obey God. Abraham obeyed. The Abrahamic covenant was ratified, and the Jewish people came into existence. Listen, Jewish people, we're not special. We really are not. God is special. Amen? God is special. It's His promises. It's Him. It's really not us. So now finally I get to our third question, and that question is, so what? You know, I don't know about you, but I believe that the Bible is alive, right? The Word of God is alive. Anytime after you look at a passage, verses of Scripture, you need to ask yourself, okay, so what? What difference does that make in my life today, living in the 21st century? Well, you know, Abraham's life is all about living by faith. By faith, Abraham, when called to go to a place he would later receive as an inheritance, obey and went, even though he didn't know where he was going. Hebrews 11:8. By faith, Abraham, Hebrews 11:9. By faith, Abraham, Hebrews 11:11. Abraham's faith is true biblical faith. Abraham's faith, biblical faith, was not based on some kind of feelings. Abraham's faith, biblical faith, is based on the promises of God. In walking by faith, all Abraham did was take God at His word and act on it. For Abraham, the central issue was, what has God promised me? I know that He will keep His promise. What has He promised me? Abraham's outlook was, whatever God has promised me, I'm going to believe it and I'm going to act on it, whether I understand everything or not. Biblical faith is all about, number one, knowing the promises of God. Number two, knowing the character of God, that He always keeps His promises. And number three, following God anywhere He leads us, because we know God keeps His word. We can look back throughout redemptive history. We can look back and see over and over and over again that we can trust God. God keeps His promises. We must realize that the whole reason why God raised up Moses and why God liberated the Jews from Egypt in such an unprecedented way is because God keeps His promises. We must realize that the whole reason why God raised up King David and why God used David in the way that he did is because God keeps his promises. We must realize that the whole reason why God sent Jesus and why Jesus went to die for our sins and the reasons why he rose from the dead on the third day is because God keeps his promises. Look at what God says in Deuteronomy 7, verses 8 and 9. He says, "But the reason that the Lord brought you out of Egypt with a mighty hand and redeemed you from the land of slavery and from the hand of Pharaoh is because the Lord loved you and because he kept the oath he swore to your forefathers. Know, therefore, that the Lord your God is a faithful God who keeps his covenants, who keeps his promises." Our God is a promise-keeping God. This is the whole basis upon which walking by faith depends. We can walk by faith because God keeps his promises. As followers of Christ, God often leads us, like he led Abraham, into uncharted waters. You know, where we have no answers. You know, where things look scary, risky, and dangerous. When God leads us like this, he calls on us to walk by faith, just like Abraham did. We walk by faith and not by sight. To help us, he's made us some promises in the Bible about everyday life. Here are a few examples. All things work together for good for those who love God. Romans 8:28. "For I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans for good and not for evil, to give you a future and a hope." Jeremiah 29:11, and I can go on and on and on. As followers of Christ, the issue is not whether we can explain everything. The issue is whether we're going to believe what God promised us and whether we will rely on God's promises as absolutely 100% trustworthy. And are we willing to let God take us into uncharted waters with only his promises to sustain us? You see, brothers and sisters, you see, there are only two choices in life. You can either doubt God or you can trust God. As follower of Christ, do you know what it means to walk by faith? Do you know what it means to view every circumstance in life in light of God's promises and then trust him? Listen, there are only two choices. Either doubt God or trust God. Without faith, it is impossible to please God. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, Lord God, we thank you so much for your word. Thank you, Lord, that it's alive. And thank you, Lord God, that we can trust you. Lord, we thank you so much for saints like Abraham, who we can look at and see him living with such great faith. And thank you, Lord God, that we can take that and emulate that in our lives. So, Lord, help us to walk by faith. Help us, Lord God, to have the faith like Abraham had, Lord. Father, thank you so much for this great place, Lord God, and this great ministry. Lord, I pray your blessings upon them, Lord, and they may they bring many to faith because of their service to you, Lord. Father, I pray your blessings upon my brothers and sisters here. And Lord God, help us to walk by faith and not by sight. Help us, Lord God, to serve you and to do what you called us to do, to be the church that you called us to be, Lord God, to be ambassadors, to shine your light in this dark world, Lord. Father, we love you so much. In Jesus' name we pray.
But let's go ahead and introduce our next speaker, Mr. Tom Cantor, president of the Scantabodies Laboratory and the Creation Earth History Museum. You all know him very well. Give him a warm welcome, Mr. Okay. Tom Cantor.
Great. Oh, thank you. I always like speaking here, getting a warm welcome because it's so different from the way the Jews treat me. You know, they don't give me such a warm welcome, so I got to come here to get my batteries recharged and realize somebody appreciates me. Anyway, so it's great to be here. Wasn't that a great man? I just was thinking to myself as Dan was speaking that I just felt. What, I got something? Okay. It's very hard to get Humpty Dumpty back together again, but here we go. Okay. All right. There we go. All right. You know, I was thinking as Dan was speaking, I don't know about you, but I could just feel like I was Abraham in Ur of the Chaldees. No other believers. And God speaks and says, go. And he says, I will give. And Abraham just says, okay. And then he goes. And it was like, oh, man, I mean, you know, right now it's like, you know, here we all are. We're believers. We got people we talk to. We look at church. And there's support. He had nothing. He was just alone. All he had was God. And with God, he just was like a child. He had the faith of a child who just went out and said, okay. And as Dan was speaking there, I felt it. I'm not supposed to work on feeling. I'm sorry. But I mean, you know, I was like, wow, what a tremendous thought just to think about going back to this point in Abraham's life, which was his greatest time. Well, tonight I want to talk about creation. And to ask the question, why is creation important? And why is this ministry and other ministries, creation ministries, why are they important? They're very important because if creation was not important, there wouldn't be all this opposition to creation. There is a true, all you have to do is objectively stand back and look at all of the statements on the History Channel, on PBS, in the university campuses, right across the board, with such a strong, it's a closed case, it's absolutely truth, don't talk about it, and you say to yourself, why? Why are they so worked up over this? So what if there's God? So what if he made everything? What's the big deal? It is a big deal. So we look at the opposition to creation, and from that opposition, we begin to understand this is a very important issue. The enemy does not fight over unimportant issues. The enemy fights over very important issues. And so it's up to us as believers to step back and say, why is the enemy fighting so hard against the truth of creation? What is the impact that the devil within his situation room, within his planning and strategy room, has made creation the number one priority here, and strategized and worked so hard through Darwin, through the education system, to make this the crown point? Why? And there is a reason why. And so the creation ministries is so important. It's not just because, well, you can't say that. You want to fight about it. It's not that. It's, you know, it's not because it cuts across what we believe. It's because it's core. It's core. Now, how is it core? How is creation core? Whether it's why is it so important? Well, first of all, as we've oftentimes said before, evolution, the anti-creation strategy, is a direct attack on what Dan was talking about, the promises of God, the Word of God. God said very clearly in the Bible, you can't miss it. If you didn't get it, ask a six-year-old. What does it say? Because he'll tell you the truth. Because the six-year-old is going to say, he said this. This is what it means. The six-year-old is not going to say, well, it says this, but let me give you a theological discussion about how it really means this. That's not going to happen. And God writes for six-year-olds. Why? Because six-year-olds believe him. Six-year-olds are like Abraham. And so when it says in the scripture, crystal clear, that God created everything, And it says that God did this in 6 days. 6 days, where the definition of a day is the evening and the morning were the day. Six 24-hour periods. I've never seen an evening and a morning be more than 24 hours. And so God says, I want you to understand that when I said day, I'm going to define it for you as between the evening and the morning. So there's no question in your mind it was six literal days. And then he said, I want you to memorialize the fact that it's 6 days by the fact that you should have a seventh day, we'll call it a day of rest, a Sabbath, to memorialize that I made everything in 6 days. So this is what he said. And so this is, okay. But most important about creation, remember Dan said, so what? So what does it matter for us? There's a big matter for us. And the matter for us is that how we are described as created. It's very important in Genesis chapter 2, verse 7, the way God described the creation of man. It says in Genesis 2, 7, the Lord God formed man. And when he uses this word formed, it's speaking about the hands. The Lord God formed man of the dust of the earth. What a picture. You ask a six-year-old, what does it mean? He formed the. It means he bent over and he took some dust and he made man. That's what it means. That's what it says. And so when we get this formed man, this is a very personal act. You know, God didn't say, all right, you know, here's the plans, angels, go do it. You know, give me a prototype so I can look it over and see if it's all right to go to mass production. You know, no, that's not what God did. That's funny, right? No. He says, yeah, angels, get out of the way. Me, God, I'm going to bend over now. Watch me. I'm going to take dust, nothing, dust. I'm going to form man with my hands. And then, He says, now watch me give him life. And so how did he give him life? How did he give him life? It says he breathed into the nostrils of this man that he formed out of the dust of the ground. He breathed into him, and then man became a living soul. Where did man come from? Think of the hands of God. He formed him out of the hands of God. How did man get life? Think of the breath of God. Think of the mouth of God breathing into man. And God says, watch my mouth. I breathed into you the breath of life. Now watch my mouth as I teach you that man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of his mouth. This is so personal. We're talking about hands and mouth. Okay? How much more personal can we get? Hands and mouth. This is what is associated with the creation of man. The personal touch of God, the personal breath of God for life. That's how it's described. When he goes on and describes this garden that he made for man, he says, he describes man, the next verse in Genesis 2:8, and he says, and the Lord God planted a garden eastward in Eden. Really? That six-year-old, what did he do? Six-year-old says, he planted a garden. Really? He didn't ask some angel. No, God planted the garden. God planted this garden. Again, this is so personal. And then it says, and there he put the man, again, whom he had formed. It says that. It put the man. He put the man. He put the man he had formed. So God wants us to know that we are the personal work of God. We are the personal work of God's hand. We have the breath from the personal breath of God. And that's why Paul, when he goes to describe in Romans 9:20, he says, oh man, who art thou that repliest against God? Shall the thing formed say to him that formed it, why have you made me thus? In other words, Paul knew, this was on Paul's mind. He says, what is man? Formed by God. Formed by God. when it talks about the, it goes on, when it talks about the sea was also formed, it says, the sea is his, he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. You know, we spend all this money, they're stupid, spend all this money to fly all the way to outer space to try to find some special planet. And God says, why are you going there? How much more special can you get a place than saying, I formed it with my hand? And so the man says, no, this can't be right. Okay. So this knowledge that we are formed by God, his personal hands, his handmade, we are handmade by God, formed. We are God-breathed. God-breathed. We have life. And the word of God is inspired. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. God-breathed. Same thing. And then David takes us from this. Now, by the way, you destroy creation. You believe this Bobbymeister, you know, that in a certain point of time, nothing exploded. Sorry. Nothing exploded. A six-year-old, what do you think? Nothing exploded? You know, a six-year-old is going to say, you crazy? Nothing exploded? Nothing exploded, and we have the universe. What do you know? In its perfection. Nothing exploded, and we have wonderful you. You say that to a six-year-old, he's going to walk away from you. He's going to say, there's something wrong with that man. He's going to, mommy, stay away from that man. He says strange things. Nothing exploded. It's a big bang. I think the big bang happened in your head or something like that. Anyway, you had a big bang and you thought that. Anyway, so this is a very foundational truth. Now we move on from there, and David, king of Israel, and I love to call David king of Israel because he is our leader. You know, the Jewish people have a very good term for Moses. Moses Rabbeinu, Moses, our teacher. We should say that. We should say, yes, Moses is our teacher. David is our king of Israel. David, he teaches us. And so he taught us in the book of Psalms what this means, that we are formed by the hand of God and we have life by the breath of God. And he says in Psalm 100, verse 3, he says, know ye. Now, that's very important when he says that. He says, you understand this. Know thee, know ye, that the Lord, he is God. We can just pause for a moment, because as Dan pointed out, we have to know that Jesus Christ is God. If you want to talk about Jewish evangelism, as I mentioned before, with Jewish evangelism, it's not an issue about whether he's the Messiah. It's not an issue about whether he's the Savior. The issue is he God? That's the Himalayas. When we work in Jewish evangelism, we are the Sherpas, and we try to bring our Jewish friends up over the hill, up to the Himalayas, up over the when they get them over the Himalayas, it's downhill from there, and the Himalayas are Jesus is God. And if they believe Jesus is God, Messiah, no problem. Creator, no problem. He's God. And if he's God and he says 6 days, what am I going to argue? You see? So know ye that the Lord, he is God. And then it says, it is he that hath made us, and not we ourselves. Now, we understand and we know that this person who made us is Jehovah Jesus. Because from John 1, there was not anything made that was made that he didn't make. All things are made by him. So it's he that made us. These hands that formed us are the same hands that he put on a cross to have nails driven through. So the hands that made us are the hands of our Redeemer. Amen. And he is God. Amen. Now, it says, know ye this, that the Lord God, he is God, he hath made us, and not we ourselves. And then it says, our place. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. You know, many of you know, in the early days of Scantabodies, had the unfortunate experience of having sheep. And I thought it was an unfortunate experience to have goats until we had sheep, and then I realized it's really an unfortunate experience to have sheep. You think goats are bad. Well, sheep are a very interesting animal. Because apart from some long-horned sheep, they're very aberrant. I don't know how they exist. We don't find sheep in wild. Sheep are domesticated animals. Sheep need a shepherd. Sheep need to be taken care of. Not goats. You know, whenever our sheep would get loose out there in Lakeside, they didn't make it. Whenever our goats got loosed, they made it. They went into wild goat herds. But our sheep didn't make it. Because sheep need a shepherd. And when it says we that he formed us and that we are his people and we are the sheep of his pasture, it means trust, what Dan was talking about. It means trust the shepherd. We are built to trust the shepherd, and the shepherd formed us with his hands. And if the shepherd did not form us with his hands, then we are not the sheep of his hands. We're not the sheep of his pasture. And who are we going to trust then? Time and chance and random processes? Yeah? The Amorites had better idols than that to bow down to and to say, oh, thank you for making me. So so why creation is so important is because it's at the core of trust. We trust the one who formed us with his hands. We trust the one who breathed in life into us by his breath. We trust the one who made us trusting sheep, sheep that need to trust. And evolution is an attack on creation, which means it's an attack on trusting God. And that's why creation ministries are so vitally important. It speaks in Psalm 95:7, he said, he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand. We are the sheep of his hand. We follow the shepherd. His hand guides us. That's the same hand that formed us. And so we're following the hand that made us. And if you destroy that foundation of creation, if you destroy the fact that his hands formed us and made us, then who are we following? It gets right down to the heart of trust. And so the six-year-old, when he says his prayers, now I lay me down to sleep, I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take. You know what that's a prayer of? It's trust. It's confidence. That's a prayer of I'm going into a very vulnerable state of sleep. I might die in my sleep, but I'm trusting the one who made me to take me and to take care of me and to protect me because he made me. And so when we come to the Lord Jesus Christ for salvation, we come to him as God. We come to him as the creator. Not just the creator of rocks, but the creator of you and the creator of me. We are hand formed. David's talked about this when he said that in Psalm 139, he said, you covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. By who? By the Savior. Made by the Savior. Marvelous are thy works. Marvelous are their works, that my soul knoweth right well. That's what the devil is trying to do. Destroy the knowledge that the soul has, that we are made by the Redeemer. That's what he's trying to, that's why it's such a big deal. That's why it's such a big deal, this attack on creation. That's why creation ministries are so very, very important. Folks, you know very well, I went into the brainwashing system. That's all I heard at UCSD. Thank God for Dr. Morris. Thank God for Dr. Henry Morris, who started the modern-day creation movement. 1964, my wife got one of the first copies of Genesis Flood. She wasn't even a science major. And she's in there underlining, you know, canopy and all these things, you know. And I was a science major. And so she's talking, she says, you know, but it says, no. But there was a museum. There was a group here in San Diego, Institute of Creation Research. There was a Dr. Dwayne Gish. We were a little tiny group at UCSD. There wasn't even a large enough group to have a campus for Crusade for Christ. There wasn't a large enough group to have an InterVarsity Fellowship. There wasn't a large enough group to have a Navigators. So we were like the battered few. And we gathered together as the battered few, and we called ourselves TCF, Trident Christian Fellowship. I think we should have called ourselves Trident Battered Few. Because we were so small. And we were so, you know, you don't believe that, you know. And really, I said, well, I guess I don't. Until our tiny little group decided we would have a debate at UCSD. Oh, the big talk was creation evolution. Oh, let's go. And people gathered to that debate like where they were going to the Colosseum to see the slaughter of the Christians that believed in creation. Oh, this is going to be good. Come on, let's go see this. And in that debate, Dr. Gish was debating Dr. Murray Goodman, who was my biochemistry teacher. And I thought, well, this is really going to be interesting. And Dr. Gish started with his bombardier beetle. I don't know if you've heard that argument, you know, and the exploding and which comes first. And, he's talking about exploding, and insects and all this stuff. And, it was very convincing. And Dr. Gish, if you knew him, you know, he was kind of like a small yapping dog that bites your heels. And he's fast. And just when you think you got him off of one heel, he's biting the other heel. And he was just quick like that, really quick with these arguments. And so finally, Dr. Murray Goodman said, the most honest, the most truthful, the really sincere thing, when he said, look, he said to Dr. Gish, it's not that my theory is more plausible than your theory. It's that I cannot accept the alternative. Oh, so you got a bias. So you're prejudiced. You've said there is no God, and creation means God. And you said you can't accept that there's God, so you can't accept creation. So that's what it's all about. That was an eye-opener for me. Why did that happen? Because there was a creation museum. Because there was a Dr. Morris, there was a Dr. Gish, there was a debate on campus where many of us were, we ought to give the Lord a hand for putting that together. And that's why it's important today. That's why Ken Ham's important. Ken Ham's, he's like a little dog that bites the heels too. That's why all these ministries are important. Because with all of this deafening sound of billions of years ago, and, evolution and Darwin, I mean, you go to the British Museum and you walk in the door there, there's an idol to Darwin. He sits at the entrance like he's the judge. And he's passing everybody. You believe in evolution? Okay. Believe in evolution? Okay. All right. You can come in. This is my museum. This is the British Museum. Yes, all right. He's sitting there like that, you know. It's like an idol. And it's deafening. It's so deafening. And so when you see this, you say to yourself, there's got to be a place where truth is spoken. There's got to be a place where there's an exhibition of science that is portrayed and says, God did this. God made this. That's why the anatomy and physiology section is all about, look at how wondrous this is, how marvelous this is. As David said, I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works. Just don't try to explain it. Just marvel at it. Just say, wow. Can you do that? As a scientist, can you just stop with the, oh, I can't go there. Can you just let your mind go there? And stop with the withered intellect and let the intellect take you where the evidence leads, to see that the Creator did this, it's marvelous. And so there's got to be a place like that. There's got to be a place where the truth is proclaimed. And I want to say this, I love church, but I want to say this, there's got to be a place outside of church. There's got to be a place outside of church where knowledge is taken, scientific knowledge, scientific information is presented, and it's explained, and it's showing that what the six-year-old already knows. That's nonsense. Nothing exploded, and somehow this all fell together. And show the nonsense of it, and yet take it one step further and show the marvel of it, and let it sink in, we are made. We're not just made by a team. We're made by the hands of God. And we have life by the breath of God. And then let that carry to the next step. If He made me, and He knows what He's doing, shouldn't I put faith in this God of creation? Shouldn't I put trust? Looks like He knows what He's doing. Shouldn't I trust God who made the circulatory system in me? So balanced with pressures that if you don't maintain, if that heart is not maintaining the right pressure, your lungs will fill with fluid. You'll drown. Just like that. Such a beautiful balance of pressure. And we could go on and on. All of the sodium and the electrolytes and the minerals are dumped out in a loop of Henle, in the nephron, in the kidney, continuously. And then there are specific channels, specific receptors that say, I need a little bit of sodium. I need a little bit of chloride. Oh, that magnesium, don't let that go out. This is going on constantly. Everything is dumped. And then there are like hands that are going out there, say, I'll take this, I'll take that, I'll take that. Oh, don't forget that, okay. Constantly. And when you eat a yogurt, that's a huge amount of calcium. You know, if you ingest a large amount of calcium, your heart's going to stop if that calcium goes too high. When you eat spinach, that binds calcium. If you bind all the calcium in the body, you'll go into tetanus. Your heart will go into tetanus. That's what happens. And yet, when we eat a yogurt or we eat spinach, a hormone instantaneously called the parathyroid hormone comes out into the bloodstream. He says, no, hold that calcium, put it in the bone. No, that's the way. And you maintain this, what's called homeostasis of calcium. Constantly, every second, while you sleep, while you wake, pressure is maintained. It keeps you alive, keeps you and me alive. Calcium is maintained. Who thought of that? Who not only thought about it, who made it happen? How does that happen? Marvel at the hands of the Creator, and then trust the hands of the Creator that put it on a cross to die for your sins. Because if you separate redemption from science, you lose. And the devil knows that. That's why there's such an attack on true science. Research, it used to have the name, it used to have the meaning of the name. Research. It's already been done. We're just trying to figure out what he did in research. We're just searching out what he already did. That's what scientific research really is. Following what God did. Figuring out what he did. So all of this is to say, this is why creation ministries are so important. Because there's got to be a place where the truth is proclaimed and where someone stands up and says, that's not true. The six-year-old can do it. The adults need to do it. This is the place where that happens. And the places of the creation ministries around the world are the place, are the places. And that's why creation ministry is so important. We trust a Creator who thought of everything. We trust a Creator who thought of everything when He made us. We trust a Creator who thought of everything when He saved us from our sins. When it comes time for us to die, you know what's really important to have as thoughts? You made me. Your hands made me. Now, those hands, Father, into thy hand, I commend myself, into those hands. Your hands formed me. Your hands made me. Now, into your hands, I give you my spirit. That's why creation's so important. Thank you very much.